नमस्कार। वी हैव बीन स्टडिंग कंसेप्ट्स एंड प्रिंसिपल्स ऑफ जैन दर्शन सो फार, एंड नाउ वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी द प्रैक्टिसेस। जैन दर्शन पर्टिकुलरली एम्फेसाइजेस ऑन पर्सनल एथिक्स, एंड यू नो द वैल्यूज आर इनहेरेंट इन एथिक्स। There is no ethics without values. So the human values, which is the subject of this particular course, are embedded in ethics, you know, which we are going to study now. Ethical living is essential for order in the society, you know. Unethical living creates, you know, so many problems. Law and order problems, moral problems, and so on. And therefore, in order that we have a brotherhood or friendship or justice and peace in the society, our living must be ethical. In the ancient times, the thinkers and the great people connected ethics and religion, you know. So the moral principles and moral behavior was part of religion at that time. So religion was the main theme, and other behavioral aspects were embedded in the religion. In Jainism, you know, the good of the society and the good of the individual are linked together. As I said, that the values are embedded or inherent in ethics. So one, what is good for one individual is also good for the society. The ethical rules prescribed for the individuals are therefore ensure, you know, friendly relations, justice, peace, and order in the society. So there is no separate division in Jain Darshan to deal with societal problems. They are more or less linked with, although social science and social relationship is described in detail, but social ethics are not very much emphasized. They are embedded in the personal ethics. Jain ethical rules are purely motivated by spiritual progress. So the ethical rules are such that the one also makes a spiritual progress. He observes personal ethics for his own good, for the good of the society, as well as these also help in the spiritual progress of the individual. Jainism prescribed separate rules of conduct for householders and for monks or ascetics. Ascetics are in a position to observe the rules in a vigorous manner, and the rules for householders are little relaxed as compared to those for ascetics. Some of the rules are common and some are different or separate. Those which are common, you know, are, as I said, less rigorously followed by the householders as compared to ascetics. Normally, vows are recommended, you know. It's not that the ethical rules are recommended in the form of vows, you know, so that one takes a vow and one takes a solemn a pledge to observe a particular ethical rule. So the rule of conduct are in the form of vows in Jainism, you know. A vow in fact protects the individual against possible lapses in conduct, you know. If you take a vow, you are serious to observe those rules. The object of the vow is to control the mind and mold one's conduct along the spiritual path, you know. So the vow helps to achieve the spiritual objective, as I said. It prevents the practitioners from evils of temptation and unregulated life, you know. So then there is very little scope that one will go for unregulated kind of life. And these rules, I said, also protects the society. So we first talk of Shravak Dharma, or the ethical conducts for householders. And later on we'll talk about the Shraman Dharma, or the ethical conducts for ascetics. Conduct or charit consists in the pursuit of what is good, beneficial for oneself and for the society, as I said, you know. So the conduct rules are such that both objectives are fulfilled, and avoid what is harmful to you and what is harmful to society. So both ways the conduct rules act, you know. First it recommends or favors, you know, what is good for you in society, and prevents you to do what is harmful to you and harmful to the society. There are five vows, and we also talked about them in the very first lecture, Anuvrati, you know. So there are five vows for the householders and also for the munis. And these vows, you know, as are observed by the householders in a little relaxed manner and in a rigorous manner by munis and ascetics. And then in the case of ascetics, these vratas are called Mahavratas, you know. And in the case of householders, we call them Anuvrata, a little vows, a small vows. Each vow has both aspects, negative and positive. It teaches what to do and what not to do, you know. Both things are emphasized in a vow. As I said, they are being, besides being personally beneficial, each vow helps individual in discharge of his social obligations. There are five anuvratas, you know, ahimsa, satya, acharya, brahmacharya, and aparigraha. They are very well defined and very well described in Jainism. Although these vratas, these rules also exist in other philosophies, but the way the details are given in Jain philosophy perhaps are not available in other philosophies. So they have been described in great detail. We first talk of Ahimsa Anuvrat. Ahimsa is the central theme of Jain philosophy. If you take out Ahimsa, what remains is only a carcass of Jain philosophy. It's the basic pillar of Jain philosophy, Ahimsa. Ahimsa, what does the Ahimsa mean? It's a very generalized definition, you know, here. Ahimsa here not only means non-killing, you know, but it means non-hurting any mobile being. The Anuvrat concept is that, you know, the householders should not hurt any mobile being. We are not talking of immobile or stavar beings here, only mobile beings. So non-hurting is a very wide perspective, a wide concept, you know. Includes hurting in any way and also killing. Hurting or hinsa is done in three ways. One, you either do it yourself, or you ask somebody else to do it, or support somebody else who is doing it. You know. Either way, when the hinsa is committed, you are guilty of it. You know. Whether you do it yourself, you are guilty. If you ask somebody else to do it, you are guilty. And if you support somebody who is doing it, then also you are guilty, you know. So it's a very wide scope of definition of hinsa. Hinsa is the highest form of religion, you know. If you observe ahimsa, you know, you have observed religion, more or less, you know. That is, it is the highest form of religion. Hinsa is given so much of importance. Hinsa, why you call violence, or why you indulge in hinsa? Because when one is overcome by passions like anger, ego, deceitfulness and greed, you know, these are the passions, you know, which make one to indulge in or violence. They are the main enemies, as I told you in the last class also. These passions are main enemies of the individual or human being, you know, and they make an individual to act in several different ways which are harmful to him, harmful to society and the person bonds karma. So patience is the main activator rather for causing hinsa. The hurt may be to your own self or to others, you know, both ways it is hinsa. Even if you hurt yourself, you are causing hinsa. That is also prohibited, you know. You should not hurt yourself in any way. And you should not hurt others, of course, that is clear. Attachment and patience are hinsa in Jainism, you know. If you are attached to a particular person or a particular object, you know, and if the attachment itself is hinsa, you know. And patience, of course, are hinsa, you know. You engage yourself or have patience at a particular moment, you are causing hinsa. Hinsa is of two kinds, you know, bhav hinsa and dravya hinsa. Bhav hinsa is the hinsa by thought, by thinking, by your bhav. So the thinking of hinsa itself is hinsa. So that is, you know, the mental condition, the mental state of a person. If the mental state is such that he is thinking of this thing, then as per Jainism, you know, he has committed hinsa. Whether he has done physically or not, that is a different matter. But even if you are thinking about it, you are thinking to commit some kind of hinsa, you know, even if you do not do it physically, you have committed hinsa. That's a very great definition. It's a very minute or fine definition of hinsa, you know. That means the hinsa first occurs in your thought, then you act and commit hinsa physically. I'll give an example, good example here. I was participating in a debate on nuclear disarmament in Parliament of World's Affairs, Parliament of World's Religions in Melbourne. And I was asked to present my Jain views, you know, on the nuclear disarmament. I emphasize this point. Look here. I mean, drav hinsa can be prevented only if you prevent bhav hinsa. If you have a thinking, and if you are thinking of hinsa, you will always indulge in physical violence or physical armament, you know. So if you have to have a disarmament, you have to modify or you have to reform your own thoughts, your mental attitude. Then only you can prevent this competition of armament and achieve the objective of disarmament. If one thinks of hinsa and patience, you know, and as I said, does not actually commit hinsa, he is guilty of hinsa, you know, and he binds karma. So you should be very careful, you know, in the way you think and where you act, you know. You keep yourself, keep your mind in a checked condition. Hinsa, what is hinsa, you know? We must clearly understand, you know. What you do is you're causing damage or hinsa, or you are hurting physically. So you are hurting body. So that way, if you see the hurting body, body is pudgal. So what are you doing? If you are doing physical harm, in fact, the soul is hurt, you know. So hinsa is that, you know, you are hurting the soul of that person through body, via body, remember, you know. And for that also, we define what is known as the vitality of prana. There are 10 pranas, you know, which are defined in a living being, in a human being. And if you sever any one of the prana, any one of the senses, or any one of the part of the body, you have committed hinsa. And remember, you know, severing body parts means hurting the soul of that person. There are five restraints for observing the vow of ahimsa. And these five restraints are control of speech. Speech is a major cause many times of ahimsa. No? You engage into arguments, you engage into unnecessary hot discussions with somebody. This is you are doing only verbally, but then you are causing ahimsa, and that it may result in physical violence. You know, many times it happens, you know. You are arguing with somebody, and then there are hot discussions, and then you engage in fighting, you know. So control in speech is a restraint, you know, which one must exercise. You must be careful what you are speaking. Control of thought. You must control your thought. I just now explained to you that, you know, thinking of ahimsa is also ahimsa. So control of thought is necessary. You must be able to exercise control in your thinking, on your mind. Regulation of movement. When you are moving, you know, and you might kill small insects or ants or something like which are there on the ground. So you must be careful in walking, you know, or moving, or, you know, when you are driving a vehicle, of course you are committing ahimsa. There is, and probably you cannot avoid it, but that must be kept to a minimum, so that, you know, you must drive as less as possible, you know. Driving for pleasure, going on long drive and so on, you are committing ahimsa. So regulation of movement, exercise care in movement, you know. So when you are walking, you must look ahead and see that you don't kill any insect or any living being, and don't hurt any living being that way. Then care in lifting and placing things, you know. So you have something, some item in your hand, and you put it on ground or table or anywhere, then also you must be careful that, you know, by putting these items, you are not killing anything, you know. So you must, that is why the munis, you know, first wipe the place with their broom or with their pichhi and churn, and then place the item there. We don't do it in practice, but we should at least take care that, you know, there are no insects or ants or something like this, or worms, on the ground or on the place where you are putting the things, and be careful that you don't commit ahimsa in this act. Then examination of food and drinks before taking in, before eating. This is very essential, you know. You must make sure that, you know, you don't eat anything which contains some kind of worm or some kind of insect or some kind of living being in it. This is very important. Even the person who is cooking has to take care, and the person who is eating also has to take care of these things, you know. Ahimsa is of two kinds. One is a sankalpi ahimsa, which is intentional, and one is arambhi ahimsa, which is occupational. You know, every one of us has one or another occupation, you know. And in this occupational work or occupational deeds, you know, we do commit ahimsa. Suppose you are doing, somebody is doing farming, well, there is a lot of ahimsa in agriculture, but that cannot be avoided. You are working in industry, you know, and in the industry also, there is a lot of violence, there is a lot of killing, you know, of small insects and small living beings, you know, but that cannot be avoided. So arambhi ahimsa is something, you know, which a householder cannot avoid, but keep it to a minimum. And sankalpa ahimsa is by intentionally you kill somebody, that ahimsa is prohibited in Jain philosophy. The sankalpa ahimsa can be in the form of hunting animals or animal sacrifices or killing animals for food, etc. This type is completely prohibited. So no Jain follower would go for hunting, no Jain follower would indulge or would even agree to or whether support animal sacrifice. Killing animals or food, all Jains are vegetarian, you know. So killing animals for food is of course prohibited, and it's a big gross hinsa. Arambhi hinsa is of three kind: udhyami, graha arambhi, and virodhi. Udhyami hinsa, which is the hinsa which is committed in the occupations. For example, making a living, you know, we have all to work for make our living so that we can feed ourselves and our family and we can meet our requirements. We have to have an occupation, you know. So in that we do commit hinsa. And this hinsa, but hinsa of five sense being is not permitted. We must at least be careful that in this thing, five sense beings are not being killed. The lower organisms, probably we cannot avoid killing of lower organisms, perhaps cannot be avoided, but must be minimized, you know. But killing of five sense beings is completely prohibited. The five sense, you know, the terrestrial animals, aquatic animals, fishes and so on, birds and so on, this is completely prohibited. Then graha arambhi hinsa, you know, in our domestic duties and obligations like cooking, bathing, raising cattle, gardening, things like this, you know, there also hinsa is involved, but you know, that must be kept to a minimum. Then virodhi hinsa. Virodhi hinsa is also many times maybe intentional, but this is permitted in with a particular purpose, you know. Not that you would go and kill anybody, this is not permitted. But if you want to defend yourself or if you want to defend your property, this is permitted, you know. If somebody is attacking or snatching your property, taking away your possessions, or somebody is attacking you and want to kill you or want to hurt you, you can defend yourself. And in this process, if hinsa is committed, this is permitted. Then defending the country, you know, this is sometimes there is a confusion, you know, and there is a kind of wrong message which is given that the Jains are ahinsavadi, or they follow ahinsa, and therefore they will not fight for the country. This is not correct. Many Jains have fought for the country. You can see the recent example of Abhinandan, you know, and we all welcomed him, that he did a brave job, he did a courageous job, he did an excellent job, you know. So the defending country is definitely permitted in Jainism. Then consumption of flesh, wine, honey and eggs is prohibited. Jains are all vegetarian. They don't eat flesh, they don't drink wine, they don't take honey. Honey is also a violent act, you know. They don't take eggs and so on. Then hunting, sacrificing animals for god worship is completely prohibited. And this is of course, you know, some kind of wrong of belief, you know, that the people indulge in animal sacrifice for god worship. This is a wrong belief. A householder cannot avoid arambhi hinsa, as I said. He must minimize it, and he must minimize it to the extent possible. This is all we had to effort, we had to exert, you know, and direct our efforts to. Ahinsa is another aspect of daya, compassion, kindness, and so on. So the two things are linked, you know. Compassion and kindness are not separately dealt with or separately described in Jainism. They are part of ahinsa. A person can be non-violent only if he has a compassion in his heart, if he has daya, if he has love for other people or other beings, you know, then only he can be a non-violent person. So it is embedded in the principle of ahinsa that, you know, daya, compassion must be observed and followed. Abhaya daan is a big daan, a bigger daan in Jainism, you know. A person engaged in violence is agitated and afflicted and is actuated by animosity. He suffers in many ways and invites legal action in some cases. So this is clear. A non-violent person has the feeling of must have, or he has maitri, love and friendship, you know. Then only he can be non-violent. So maitri and friendship, love and friendship is a part of ahimsa. Then pramod, or respect, joy and respect, you know. You must have joyful attitude towards other, you must respect others, pramod. So it's a part of ahimsa. Karuna, compassion, it's a part of ahimsa, as I said. And madhyastha bhava, tolerance, you know. There are people who don't, you don't agree. But then that does not matter. You take a madhyastha stand, you know. So be indifferent to them, you know. Don't be angry with them or don't be annoyed with them, you know. You just have an indifferent attitude, madhyastha bhava, tolerate them. So that you don't commit violence or hinsa in any way by way of your patience, of anger, etc. So even if you don't agree with somebody, or somebody doesn't agree with you, okay, fine, you know. So you be tolerant about it. So that way there are detailed rules prescribed for ahimsa, anuvrata. I have just given you a gist of the main approaches which are described for ahimsa anuvrata. Ahimsa anuvrata is also followed by ascetics, as I said. This is a Mahabharata and we will discuss about it later when we talk of Mahabharata. Thank you.